single page, and we're ready to get the party started. Okay, cool. All right. So again, if anything is not clear, feel free to unmute yourself or type in the chat. I am monitoring the chat, and if you have questions, just unmute yourself and we can talk about it. Also, let me make this disclaimer. I do the best I can with emails. I'm not going to lie. When I'm not with you guys, I'm ripping and running. Either I'm grading something or I'm working another job so I can eat. Like, it's no joke, right? So I say that to say, if you email me about something and if I don't respond by the next time we meet, just bring it up during class, all right? And we can talk about it kind of towards the end of class. Idealistically, the way I envision running this is that, you know, idealistically, I would have my pre-recorded lectures up in advance so you guys can get ahead. But again, this is, with you all, this is my first time actually creating these, the recordings. So they're not already available. So I have to kind of do the best I can to get ahead. But, you know, so like we just completed section 3.1. We're about to do 3.2 now. But again, idealistically, I can pump out as many of those pre-recordings ahead of time as possible so you can watch them at your leisure. And once we start doing that, what that does is free up the time when we're together so we're not so locked in, right? Like, okay, we need to go through the lecture. We can actually go through homework or quizzes or exams. We can review this stuff together during class if we watch the lectures, if the lectures are available and we watch them before class, right? But if this is no fault of your own, if I don't make them available beforehand, then obviously during class, we need to be live and go through the lecture, which is what we're doing now, right? So if I don't do it in advance, then I'll just do it live. And, you know, my stuff is ready to go. It's just, like I say, just making the recording. But again, if I don't respond to the email promptly, then just bring it up at the next live session and we can talk about it then. Just because, you know, it just be random stuff going on. Okay, so... okay, you're working. So the next section in chapter 3 with logic, in section 3.2, compound statements and connectives, right? Compound statements and connectives. So again, in the previous section, we saw how to identify a statement. A statement is just a sentence that's either true or false. Examples of things that are not statements will be opinions, commands, and questions, right? So those are examples of things that are not statements. So then once we identify a sentence as a statement, we also started labeling the statements with letters, right? So we can convert a sentence or compound statement, we can convert those into symbolic form, right? And so the first official symbol was, you know, that we introduced aside from the letters was the not symbol, which was the tilde. I showed you another one. I don't know that this book uses that symbol, but just in case it pops up, the other not symbol is like a sideways 7, right? But I think this book uses the tilde symbol, which is the squiggly line, the first one that we introduced, okay? Okay. Oh, no. Are you doing that thing? You are doing that thing. Okay, let me back up. Come on, you got it. There's that one. Cool. So some objectives here. We like to express compound statements in symbolic form, express symbolic statements with parentheses in English, and use the dominance of connectives, right? So let's just look at these concepts. So we have simple and compound statements. A simple statement conveys one idea with no connecting words, right? Okay, so that's just a statement that's either true or false. Compound statements combine two or more simple statements using connectives, right? Some examples of connectives would be like and or. We have several that we'll talk about. Here they are right here. Connectives are words used to join simple statements. Examples of connectives are and, or, if then, and if and only if, right? And we'll go through what do we mean by these separate connectives, okay? So, you know, the main way that I know that we use logic, again, logic is like, we use it often when we're proving something is either true or false. We start with like, again, just to kind of recap, what do we mean by logic? We start with like our universal set, like we're talking about this topic, right? And then we start with like some hypothesis or a conjecture, something that, or an axiom, something that everybody agrees is true, right? We all agree that 2 + 2 = 4, right? We'll start there. And then through a logical flow or a logical calculus, you know, well, this means that, and this means this, and this means this. So therefore, this has to be the case, right? So that whole flow, that whole structure is similar to like, in science with the scientific method, it's similar to that, but it's like a mathematical version of that. the concepts we talk about here in logic are used often in law. I've used it to win cases, like where I challenge like cops and that pull me over and I take them to court. You know, my first line of defense is hoping that they just don't show up. But then they show up. I was like, okay, well, that's fine. And then at least on two separate occasions, like I beat the cops because I was like, you know, that's a whole nother story. I'll share that story later. But again, this whole logical flow is used often in law, right? So mathematicians typically make good lawyers, right? Not all lawyers make good mathematicians, but the whole thing about law is proven beyond a shadow of a doubt, either this person is guilty or this person is innocent, right? And that's actually using the stuff that we're using here. They'll take the scenario, you know, my client was here, but there's no way that he could have been here because you got it on camera that he was here, his face was shown, and there's no way with that distance, you know, he was doing the speed limit. There's no way for him to be back home to cause whatever you're trying to claim it of. So beyond a shadow of a doubt, my client is innocent, right? Stuff like that. Another way that logic is used is actually how we're communicating right now. We're all communicating on these devices. I don't know if you would call them smart devices because they definitely throw tantrums. Our device was definitely throwing a tantrum on last Tuesday, right? A couple of days. But basically what I mean is like the coding, right? So when we do programming and coding, that's actually this logic. The stuff that we're talking about here. So when we use like, you know, software, our smart devices, the computers, the systems, like with the lights and cues and lines, it's all over the place, right? But yeah, so those are just some examples of where the concepts of logic are used in our everyday lives, whether we're aware of it or not. So we're kind of, with this chapter, we're kind of, you know, just exploring some of those concepts. So let's look at this. Yeah, we kind of talked about this already. So the first connective we want to kind of, yes, yeah, I'm taking attendance. So I am relying on it's supposed to be taking the attendance automatically. You know, it's a little bit trippy. I have some ways to kind of like follow up. I see that you're here. I saw you when you came in and it is being recorded. So don't worry about it. As long as you make it until the team call, then you've gotten your credit, and I'll make sure that you get your credit. And honestly, with the attendance, you know, especially like the past couple of weeks, I'm not going to be super strict about that, right? Like, obviously we need to meet, but, you know, the past couple of weeks, for whatever reasons, technical issues or whatever, as long as you're like getting your assignment submitted promptly and you're reaching out to me saying, hey, you know, I'm here, or I'm sorry about this class. Like, if you missed, I usually mark the students as excused. Just try to get your attendance credit. I usually try to be a little bit light with you guys. So as long as you're getting your attendance and submitting your assignments on My Open Math, you're good to go. Like, that's the main stuff. Getting your attendance at each session and submitting yourself on My Open Math. And again, I usually update my grades on My Open Math. I've been trying to do it like once a week, again, on Tuesdays and Wednesdays, right? So that's the long and short there. Okay. So there's a little bit more there, but I'm going to get back to this. So when it comes to the and statement, right? So that's our first connective, right? So if we have two simple statements, P and Q, then the compound statement P and Q is symbolized as, that's called the land symbol, L, like the logical and, we call that land. But we read it as P and Q, right? So this symbol, which is like a triangle without a base, right? That's called the logical and symbol. We call it land. And when we're using it, we just say and, right? So this is read P and Q, right? And so it says the compound statement formed by the connective statement with the word and is called a conjunction. So whenever we use the connective and, it's called a conjunction. And the symbol for and is going to be, again, this is called the land symbol, which means logical and, okay? All right, let's see. There should be some more there. So let P and Q represent the following simple statements. P is, it is after 5 p.m. Q is, they are working, right? So then we're asked to write each compound statement below in some symbolic form, right? So with A says it's after 5 p.m. and they are working, right? It's after 5 p.m. and they are working. So P is, it's after 5 p.m. Q is, they are working. And this is a conjunction that combined with N. So then in symbolic form, this is just going to be P and Q. That's it. This, like, bar with a double slash, that's just my way of boxing my final answer, just to highlight what my final answer is, so it jumps off the page. Sometimes I'll put the final answer in a box. Sometimes I'll do this little simple. Right? For B, it's after 5 p.m. and they are not working. So it's after 5 p.m. is a P, and they are not working, so we're going to say not Q. We could put this in parentheses, so that way we do the not Q first, but we're going to see momentarily that in this instance, we don't necessarily need the parentheses, because if we're trying to decide to address the not versus the and, we're going to see that the not takes priority over the and, right? We're going to see the order of priority when it comes to these connectives. All right, so we're just going to kind of go with this for right now. Let's see what's in our prepared notes, right? I think the prepared notes have the same thing that we have. So for part A, we have P and Q. So that's what we got. Part B is P and not Q. Okay. So hopefully this is okay. You guys hear me okay? Oh, I know what I'm looking for. Captions. There we go. Let's see. Testing. Can you guys hear me? Testing. Yeah, cool. So my captions let me know that the audio is being pushed. I know you guys can. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. I know you can hear me because usually you guys would say something by now, and I was like, what am I missing? And I was looking for my captions. So anywho, we found them. I think we're good here. So, you know, right now this is kind of introductory. It's fairly light, you know, but let's just kind of keep going. Let's keep going and see where it takes us. Okay. So common English expressions for P and Q, right? So common, what's it called? Conjunctions, right? Common conjunctions. This is kind of a tongue twister. That's why I was having trouble getting that out. Okay, so P and Q, one way that we'll see it is P and Q. And an example would be, it's after 5 p.m. and they are working, right? Another way we see the conjunction is P but Q. It means the same thing. And an example would be, it's after 5 p.m., but they are working, right? So but and mean the same thing in this context. Another way that we see a conjunction is P yet Q, right? So all three of these mean the same thing. It's after 5 p.m., yet they are working, right? So if you see but or yet, it just means and. And lastly, another way we'll see it is sometimes it'll say nevertheless. Again, all of these mean the same thing. It's after 5 p.m. Nevertheless, they are working, right? So these phrases can be used interchangeably. Okay. All right. So now we saw examples using the connective and, right? So now let's see, what do we mean by or? Right. Let's start to explore or statements. This is another connective. The connective or can mean two different things. Consider the statement, I visited London or Paris. This statement can mean exclusive or inclusive. Exclusive or means I visited London or I visited Paris, but not both. Versus inclusive or means I visited London or I visited Paris or I visit both. Right? Inclusive means we can include both. Exclusive means it's exclusively one or the other. Right? So or does take on two different forms. So the or that we typically work with is the inclusive or. Let me see if we have the symbols on the next slide. All right? Yeah, let me kind of put this. So like how we had the connective and was the land symbol, that triangle. Well, the or symbol, which is called logical or lore, is basically a V, right? So the V usually is still the second one, the inclusive or. Exclusive or takes on the form of a circle with the crosshairs in the center. That's exclusive or, right? So if we see that symbol, the circle with a cross through, that means exclusively one or the other, but not both. That's called exclusive or. Inclusive or is the one that we typically work with, which is the V. That means the first one is true, or the second one is true, or they could both be true, right? Inclusive or. Okay? So again, hopefully we're all aboard and we're not all bored. if you have questions, feel free to unmute yourself to ask or type in the chat. I am monitoring the chat. otherwise, we're going to kind of press forward. Okay. Come on. There we go. So where and is a conjunction, right? Or it's called a disjunction, right? Disjunction is a compound statement form using the inclusive or represented by the symbol. We call that's called the LOR symbol, L, logical or, you can just say or, right? So thus P or Q or both is symbolized as P, is symbolized here, P or Q, okay? Okay, so let's look at an example on translating from English to symbolic form. So we're going to let P and Q represent the following simple statements. P is going to be the simple statement, the bill receives majority approval. Q is going to be the simple statement, the bill becomes a law. So then we're asked to write each compound statement below in symbolic form. Write each compound statement below in symbolic form. So for part A, we have the bill receives majority approval, or the bill becomes law, right? So the bill receives majority approval is P, right? We just introduced logical or, so that's going to be basically a V. It just means or, inclusive or. The bill becomes law is Q, right? So that just means P or Q. Okay. Again, if you have questions, feel free to unmute yourself. Or type in the chat. For part B, it says the bill receives majority approval or the bill does not become law, okay? So the bill receives majority approval, that's a direct translation for P, or, so that's our logical or, the bill does not become law. So that's gonna be not Q. So tilde Q. Okay. Let's see what we got here. So P or Q, and then P or not Q. Okay. All right. So we're going to let that be. I feel like that's not too difficult. But if it's not clear, you have to speak up. A closed mouth doesn't get fed. If you don't say anything, then I have to assume one of two things. Either you get it or you just don't want to say anything. Right. So until you say something, then, you know, my job is like to be available, one. Right. So I try to make myself available as best I can and then, you know, try to answer your questions as best I can. So this diagram, so like the if then statement. So now we're moving on to the next connector. Right. So we kind of explore the logical and. Right. And, you know, how that'll show up. We explore the logical or, which is basically the V and how that shows up. So then the if then statements. Right. If then, if this, then that. Right. This, let's just look at this. So this diagram shows a relationship that can be expressed three different ways. All poets are writers. Notice that the poets are completely contained within the writers, right? So this shows that some writers are not poets, but all poets are writers. There are no poets that are not writers. If a person is a poet, then that person is a writer. All right? So these three statements are synonymous, right? So whenever we see if-then statements, we can kind of think like this one circle contained with another. Hang on. What's this? No, okay. Ooh. Cool, cool, cool. Cool beans, okay. Let's keep it moving. Let me get back so I can see. Cool. Okay, so as we kind of start to explore, whenever we see if then, we can think, you know, the first statement completely contained within the second statement, right? Okay, let's see if we can see an example. So this is called the conditional statement, right? So the compound statement, if P then Q, symbolized as the right arrow. This is read, if P then Q, this is the if then statement. This is called a conditional statement. So we've explored, a conjunction, we've explored a disjunction. Now we're looking at a conditional statement. So the statement before the the implication symbol is called the antecedent. The statement after is called the consequence. So the antecedent and then the consequence, right? So the antecedent implies the consequence. Consequences, right? From my, what's that show, Key and Peele? Consequences, it's so random. The show's so silly. But yeah, the antecedent comes before the symbol and the consequence comes after. So let P and Q represent the following simple statements. P is a person, is a father. Q is a person, is a male. Here we're asked to write each compound statement below in symbolic form. So if a person is a father, then that person is a male, right? So a person is a father is a direct translation. So we can just put the symbol. So that's an if then. So we're going to use the implication symbol or the right arrow. That person is a male. Oh, this is controversial in this day and age. Man, I don't even want, I'm not touching that with a 10-foot pole. I'm just going to do this example and leave it be, right? Because I don't have time for that discussion. I'm going to leave that alone. But yeah, I want to talk about it, but I don't want to talk about it, right? So I'm going to leave it at me. But yeah, so this was pretty much a direct translation. It's not, that one's not difficult. We're going to let that be. Okay, P implies Q, and we see it there. Okay. All right, so that was the conditional statement. All right, so let's look at another example. So let P and Q represent the following simple statements. P is a person is a father. Q is a person is a male. Write each compound statement below in symbolic form. If a person is not a male, then that person is not a father. Man, why did we get this example? Not a male, right? So we will say not a male is going to be not Q. If that, then, right? Not a father, we're going to say not P. That's the translation of that sentence. Okay. So hopefully we're all aboard, and we're not on board. If you have questions, you just got to ask. If you're good, then we're going to keep moving. Not Q implies not P. Okay, so far we're pretty good. All right. So some common English expressions for the conditional statement, P implies Q. So I want to say all these different rows are equivalent. These are different ways that we say the same thing. Right. So the first one is P implies Q. If P, then Q. If a person is a father, then that person is a male. Another way we might do it is Q if P. All right. So notice the order has reversed. Q if P. A person is a male if that person is a father. Right. Right. So it's almost like the thing after the if kind of holds in this case. But notice, so there's another case where it's a little bit different. P is sufficient for Q, right? So again, these all mean the same thing. If P, then Q. Q if P. P is sufficient for Q. Q is necessary for P. Okay. I know whenever I kind of come across these alternate ones, I do kind of tend to refer back to like this chart because it can be a little bit in flow. It's like it can be a little bit of a challenge to remember. But as long as you can identify that these are all synonymous, and then you just have to kind of straighten out the order. P only if Q, and then only if Q, P, right? So again, all of these mean this first guy here. These are all synonymous, just different ways of writing the same thing. Let me see. So notice that with the first two, you know, when the P comes after the if, then it just means P implies Q. But then with the only if we see the only, if it says only if Q, then you know, that Q is the consequence, right? So the only difference is if only is there, then, you know, it's one of these last two cases. If the only is not there, then it's one of these first two cases. And then you just have to take some time to straighten this part out. Because notice that the necessary is reversed. Okay, again. So again, when we start coming across these other examples, I tend to refer back to this chart just to kind of keep it straight, right? But as long as you're aware that you're talking about a conditional and you just get the order proper, you're good to go, all right? So then now, we've seen a conjunction, a disjunction, we've seen a conditional statement, and now we're looking at the biconditional statement, which is the if and only if statement. Biconditional statements are conditional statements that are true if the statement is still true when the antecedent and consequences are reversed, right? So the biconditional, like if you have, it essentially means P implies Q and Q implies P. If you reverse the order and it's true in either case, then we have a double error going on. If a person is a father, then that person is a male, if that's true. If a person is unmarried male, then that person is a bachelor, I'm assuming. Not necessarily true, right? So if a person is a father, then that person is a male. That's true. If a person is a male, then that person is a father. That's not necessarily true, right? Okay. If a person is unmarried male, then that person is a bachelor. That's true. If a person is a bachelor, then the person is unmarried male. That's also true. So the compound statement P, if and only if Q, abbreviated as IFF, is symbolized P biconditional Q, right? So P, if and only if Q. So I think what this example was showing was that, generally speaking, implication is not always true. Like, if you have P implies Q, the reverse is not necessarily true. But if you reverse the order and it remains true, then that's when we have the biconditional. All right, let's see. So these are different ways that we'll see the biconditional displayed. So, you know, we have P if and only if Q, right? Q if and only if P. Again, it's almost like a logical equal symbol. You can reverse the order and it'll reserve the truth value. If P, then Q. Also, if Q, then P. So that's like an if then, right? But I think you need to have both of these need to be true. P implies Q and Q implies P. Therefore, the biconditional is true. P is necessary and sufficient for Q. Okay. So what this example did was combine the two from the previous, right? We had P is sufficient for Q and Q is necessary for P. So then if we say P is sufficient and necessary for Q, that's the biconditional. It combines those two together with the conjunction. Q is necessary and sufficient for P. It's a similar, just reverse order, right? So again, once we start kind of like working through examples, I feel like this will sink in. Let's keep going. Okay, so the negation of these guys. Oh, so this is a summary of the connectives that we've introduced in this section, right? So we have our negation symbol. It basically reverses the truth value of our statement. A conjunction is combining two simple statements with an and. A disjunction combines two simple statements with an or. Conditional is P implies Q, or if P, then Q. And biconditional is if P implies Q and Q implies P, then you could say like P biconditional Q, like, you know, it's basically like a logical equal symbol. Okay. I'm still trying to get to an example instead of these like generic examples. Okay. Let's look at this one. So let P and Q represent the following simple statements. P is she is wealthy and Q is she is happy. Write each of the following symbolic statements in words. Okay. So let's see. If we just focused inside the parentheses and we said P and Q, then we could say what? She is wealthy and she is happy. But then with that tilde in the front, we want to negate that whole thing. So then we can actually tack on a negation in front of the statement. So we can say something like, I think I'm going to just type this out with my keyboard. Let me see. Instead of writing it, because my handwriting is so beautiful, I'm going to type it. Nope. That's not what I'm. Yeah, that's what I want. Okay. So, so let me start with the part inside the parentheses. Come on. Throwing the tantrum again. Let's try this again. On the text box. Okay, cool. Oh, are you not on or something? There we go. Okay. So if we're saying P and Q, so we're saying she is wealthy and she is happy, right? So that's just P and Q. So then to negate this, on front of it, I'm going to put I'm going to negate this by saying it is not the case that, and then that way it negates whatever we just said. Okay, that should suffice. Okay, let's try another one. Let me see. So with B, we have not P and Q, right? But notice there's no parentheses here. So what that means is that the not only applies to the P, right? So we should be able to do the following. We just need to negate P, so we can say she is not wealthy and she is happy, right? So that way we only negate the first simple statement, and then we left the other one as is. Okay, so now we're negating a disjunction, all right? So if we focus on the part that's just inside the parentheses first, that's what? What symbol is that? Anybody got that in the chat? What symbol is that? Right? Give you a moment, once, twice, right? So that's the or symbol, right? That's the logical or. So let's just do the part inside the parentheses first. I'm watching the clock. I think we got right at about a little over 20 minutes remaining. So we'll do what we can with the 20 minutes. So the part inside the parentheses, we can say what? She is wealthy or she is happy. Right? She is wealthy or she is happy. Okay? But then because of the tilde, we want to negate that. So then we're just going to put, we're going to precede it by it is not the case. Nope. It is not the case that she is wealthy or she is happy. We could probably rewrite that as she is not wealthy nor, let me see. She is neither wealthy nor happy. All right, let me put that as an alternative. So I'm going to say as an alternative, maybe we can say she is not wealthy nor happy. I think that's okay. No, I feel like that should actually be in the first one. I'm going to not use the alternative. I'm going to just go with this one. Okay, so let's see how do we do, right? Let's see. Now, they might have something different. Let's go like this. So it is not true that she is wealthy and happy, right? I think that's what we had. It is not the case that she is wealthy and she is happy. That's fine. She is not wealthy and she is happy. We got that one. She is neither wealthy nor happy. So that was the alternative, right? But I think what we have is fine as well. She is neither wealthy nor happy. Literally, it is not true that she is either wealthy or happy, right? So it's okay. Okay, solid 15 minutes, and we got about just under 10 slides remaining. So we have this, let me see. So expressing symbolic statements with parentheses in English, right? So the parentheses basically identify the order of operations, like what we should focus on first. And generally speaking, when we have these multiple connectors, there is a certain order in which we do it. I'm just trying to bide my time until it shows up. Notice that when we translate the symbolic statement into English, the simple statement in parentheses appears on the same side of the comma. So we have Q and not P implies not R. Statements to group together, Q and not P, that's fine. So then if Q and not P, then not R, right? If Q and not P, comma, then not R, right? Okay. It's the if then because of the right arrow. The second one is Q and not P implies not R, right? So again, notice that when we translate, the simple statements in parentheses appear on the same side of the comma. So Q and not P, if not P, then not R, right? Okay. Okay, so let's see it in action. So let P, Q, and R represent the following simple statements. P is a student misses lecture. Q is a student studies. R is a student fails, right? So then we write each of these symbolic statements in words. Okay, so let's give this a go. Okay. So we know that the simple statements that's in the parentheses need to be on the same side of the comma. So we can say what? If Q and not P, so if a student studies and does not miss a lecture, So if a student studies and does not miss lecture, comma, right? Let me kind of shift this. If a student studies and does not miss lecture, then they do not fail. The student does not fail. That's really interesting. Okay. Right. So again, we tried to group all the parts, the simple statements with the connectors that were in the parentheses. We grouped them together by keeping them on the same side of the comma. And then we just kind of did a direct translation of the simple statements with the connectors. Right. All right, so we have, if a student studies and does not miss lecture, then the student does not fail. If a student studies and does not miss lecture, then the student does not fail. Okay. All right, so hopefully we're all aboard and we're not all bored, right? Maybe I might, once we finish this section, I'll share that story with how I beat the cops in court. I remember one of them. Yeah. It just depends. Let me see the time, though. Because once we finish this section, this is going to be it for today. And we got through two sections today, so that's pretty good. So we got that one. Okay. All right, so this is part B of the same example, okay? So notice we have a certain portion that's within parentheses. So we want to be sure that those are on the same side of the column, right? Okay? I'm not writing this. So then Q is what a student studies. Okay, so let's start there. There we go. Okay, so Q is a student studies and this looks weird. Let me kind of go like this. Let me see. Because the part inside the parentheses says what? If a student does... Okay, a student studies and... If a student does not miss the lecture, then the student does not fail. If the student does not miss lecture... If the student does not miss lecture, then, well, there should be a comma there. Then the student does not fail. Then the student does not fail. Okay. A student studies and if the student does not miss lecture, then the student does not fail. It looks a little weird, but that's if we follow what we did previously, right, this should be the case. So we're going to go with this. And let's see. A student studies, okay, so that's where I thought the comma should go. And there is an additional comma. Okay, so some augmentations. So what we have was essentially correct, just a little bit of, I guess, grammar. The comma should go here. And then if we say, if the student does not miss lecture, there should be a comma right here. Then the student does not fail. So that was the only thing that we were missing. The rest of it we got. And can I change the style? I'm going to change this to this color. Just so you know that that's something I introduced. Because I'm human. I definitely make mistakes. So it's just my job as your professor is to minimize those mistakes. You know, we have moments of perfection, but as humans, we're designed for trial and error, right? We're supposed to make mistakes, right? So that's why I do unlimited attempts, you know, because there's a whole philosophy there. I'm going to let that be for now. Just let that be what it is. Okay, so we kind of made a few corrections there, but otherwise we essentially got it. Okay, we got a couple of more slides. If a symbolic statement appears without parentheses, statements before and after the most dominant connectors should be grouped. Okay, so the dominance of connectors used in symbolic logic is defined in the following order, right? So earlier I was mentioning that there's a certain order in which we prioritize these symbols. This is that priority. The symbol that gets the highest parentheses, the symbol that gets the highest priority is negation, right? So if we have to choose between multiple symbols at once, we do our negations first. Wait a minute. Yeah, we do our negations first. So that's going to be the first thing that we do. Once we settle our negations, the next set of symbols that get order of priority is our conjunction and disjunction, right? Whenever we have the and or that we have to decide at the same time, we can just do that left to right. But so if we ignore parentheses, because parentheses take the priority over everything, aside from parentheses, we do negations first, and then we do our ors and our ands, right? And we can just do that essentially left to right. Once we settle all the ands and the ors, next is a conditional statement. So that's the next one. And then the most dominant symbol or the symbol that we do last is going to be our biconditional symbol. Okay. Let's see if we get an example. Darn. Okay. So it's already kind of worked out for us. Okay. So for instance, in this first example, we have several connectors and we have to decide, okay, the most dominant is going to be the symbol that we do last, right? So if we had to decide between conditional, logical, and the not symbol, the most dominant is the conditional. That's why this type of statement is a conditional statement, right? In the second example, if we had to decide between and, the conditional, and not, again, this is still conditional. That's the most dominant. In this third one, we have a biconditional. So biconditional in this case is going to be the most dominant. So this is a biconditional statement. Another biconditional statement. And this last one, it looks like the most dominant is going to be conditional here. So this is a conditional. Okay. So grouping symbols must be given with this statement in order to determine do they mean P and Q or R? Right, which is a disjunction, or P and Q or R, right? So whenever we have connectors that are on the same level, this is called an ambiguous case, and the problem should give us parentheses, right? So, you know, we really should not be coming across this, but, you know, because these are on the same level, we should be given some parentheses so we can identify which is more dominant, right? So again, this is an ambiguous case, okay. Okay, so let's try. Okay, we have a few more slides, and we got just under 10 minutes. Okay, so let P, Q, and R represent the following simple statements. P is going to be the simple statement, I fail the course. Q is going to be the simple statement, I study hard. R is going to be the simple statement, I pass the final. We're asked to write each compound statement in symbolic form. Okay, so for part A, we have I do not fail the course if and only if I study hard and I pass the final. Okay, let's see. If and only if, right? So, okay. So what we can do is just do a direct translation with the symbols and then introduce parentheses retroactively, right? I do not fail the course is going to be what? Not P. Oops. It's going to be, and let's do this in purple. So this is going to be not P. If and only if is biconditional, so we capture that by a double arrow. I study hard is going to be Q, and is going to be the logical and, I pass the final, which is R, right? So this is just a direct translation. if we wanted to introduce parentheses, now this is a biconditional statement because the most dominant symbol is the biconditional. If we wanted to introduce parentheses, we could introduce parentheses here and here. Okay, I'm just going to go with this for now, and we'll see this worked out in our prepared notes momentarily. So with B, I do not fail the course. So fail the course is what P. So then I do not fail the course is going to be not P. If and only if is biconditional. I study hard is Q. Wait a minute. What's the difference? I do not fail the course if and only if. Oh, they have a comma. Okay. Okay. If and only if I study hard and I pass the final. Okay. All right. So with this one, because of that comma, study hard is the Q. So it looks like we need to group this like this because of the placement of that comma. This should be sufficient. Okay. We might not need the parentheses in the first one. So that's why I left it in blue. Okay, let's see. Let's look at our prepared notes. Okay, so they just kept the second one. Okay, so that's fine. I will get rid of the first set of blue. Oops, let's undo. All right, so we were close. Undo on the first one. We were a little bit off, but that's okay. The second one, we got it correct, right? Because of the comma, that means we needed to group everything before Q and everything back to the beginning. Right. All right. I think that might be it. Let's see what we got on the next slide. Okay. So I do not fail the course if and only if I study hard and I pass the final. Because the most dominant connective is the biconditional, the symbolic form with parentheses, this didn't display properly. I think that's it too. Yeah, I think that honestly goes, I just have to strike through this because it's not displayed properly just because of like formatting stuff. So you can ignore that. I personally would say it's like what we had before, right? Because what we had before, it was nothing wrong with it, but it should be something like this. Because that way the most dominant connective is the biconditional. You know, we do the left part, we do the right part, and then the final result forces it on the biconditional. And with that, we have 5 minutes remaining, right? I usually, the last 5 minutes, I just kind of do closing remarks. Let me go ahead and make a copy of this available. I want to share, send it to Box. This is the fall. This is Morris Brown. Notes updated daily. And yes, this is 3.2, right? So when this bar finishes loading, you'll receive a copy of anything that you saw me writing. I'm going to use these recordings as my official recordings going forward, but that's a mute point. So, you know, I'll do the best I can to try to load the recordings for chapter 3. If I don't load them in advance, then I'll just do them live when we meet like I did today. Are there any burning questions before we go our separate ways? That's okay. Yeah, as long as you made it into the call, because we've been having like technical issues, right? As far as multiple rooms apparently and stuff like that. As long as you make it in, you get your attendance credit. I'm not gonna make a big deal about that. The main things that I need from you on my end, make an effort to get your attendance credit. You know, if you miss, at least be in communication. Usually when students are in communication, then I usually mark them as excused. Because I don't really want attendance to be an issue. It's really only an issue when they're like no show, no call, right? Yes, we can. So as long as students are making a genuine effort for attendance, I usually work with the students. So all I need is just basically attendance on a regular basis. And then as long as you're getting your assignment submitted on MyOpenMath, those are the main components. I've already scheduled like all the homework and quizzes are available right now for the semester. You don't have access to pre-recorded lectures just because I haven't created them. So it's going to be a little bit difficult for you to get ahead. But, you know, we'll kind of monitor that and keep on top of that. But at least the assignments are available. There's also a free digital e-textbook that you can find in Populi. So if you go to Populi, and you go to like the link where the syllabus is, on the right-hand panel is where you can find a digital copy of the e-textbook. So you don't have to like purchase anything. My Open Math is free, you know, things of that nature. Aside from Mr. Donovan, are there any other burning questions? Does anybody have any other burning questions for me? Okay, going once, going twice. If there aren't any burning questions, we're going to go ahead and end the session here. And from one beautiful mind to another, have a great weekend. You guys are awesome. And I will see you all. Thanks for inviting me, because I guess if you guys can get into this room, then that's fine by me, because I was in the other one. But as long as we're all together, it's all that I really care about. Otherwise, have a great weekend, and we'll meet next Tuesday, same time, same place. Take care, guys. Peace. So give me just a moment to kind of like try to make a private room. Okay, what was this one? That looks good. Okay, let me stop the recording.